I hear you guys just fine.
Hello, hello. Testing, 1, 2, testing.
This is Andy, testing my mic. Andy.
Testing, 1, 2, testing.
This is Andy testing my mic right now. Andy, eating my McChicken to Looksmax over here. Be right back, Looksmax and McChickens.
Oh, yeah, McChicken. Yeah, I had a McChicken today earlier, actually.
Yeah, I actually don't like that sauce they put on there. What the fuck?
Yeah, it's not the greatest. I much prefer the Big Mac sauce.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It is what it is.
Yeah, I buy it because, you know, I could buy like 10 at a time for like $10.
You might say it's a low-status McDonald's item.
It is. You know, it's from the dollar menu, but it satisfies your hunger, at least.
Yeah.
For cheap, so.
Mm-hmm. Can't hear you?
Yeah.
Can they not hear me anymore?
Can you guys hear me now? Monkman, let me know if you can hear me. Alright, the audio should be good now, fellas. So go ahead. So the part they didn't, we got a backup. So they didn't hear the introduction. So this is, thank you guys for tuning in. This is part two of my conversation with Andy and Andy Ness, who offered a lot of solutions for people who are in a particular bind. And, you know, we explored solutions in my last video featuring him. And now we want to do part two just to, so every stone that wasn't unturned, we want to make sure that we go through everything. You know what I mean? And also we have joining the call.
Last time we were just shooting.
What's that, Andy?
The top where we're at last time, I mean. So we came up with some other stuff also talking the other day. So
exactly. So, and we also have on the call, we have Albert C, who was also in a previous live stream. You guys might remember him. So Albert,
yeah, I've been
like
in
to...
a...
So Albert, sure, please introduce yourself, yes.
All right, yeah, I've been on Heat and Succeed's past live streams. I've been on a couple of his streams in the past, as well as a few of his videos. And I volunteered to join today to have a conversation about the subject matter. And a little bit about myself. I'm currently 25 years old, and I have been a TFLer in the past for long stretches of time. And, you know, I would, I'm definitely considered low status in terms of socioeconomic. You know, I don't really make that much money, and I believe myself to be below average on the 1 to 10 scale in terms of aesthetics. So, yeah.
All right. And so basically what we could take away from that is, you know, you're somebody who is not getting what you want in a particular situation, and you ultimately to explore solutions to see what can you do to actually get what you want.
Right. Yeah. I mean, you know, like the solutions, I believe the solutions are, I believe the only way to remedy any TFLs, you know, in seldom is to Looksmax. I'm a full-heartedly believe that Looksmax is the golden key. It's the only way to do it. The problem is, though, it's like It depends on what you need done. Like, it, for each individual, you know, like, you have to identify the problems that you have, and you have to find the right way to address them. So, for example, let's say if you have crooked teeth, all right, then common sense would dictate that you need to go to a dentist so you can get braces and straighten them out. And, you
Right.
know, that's how you need to go about in addressing your issues, whatever it is that you
Absolutely.
have.
Can you do that Invisalign stuff now? I don't know anything about it. I'm just
Yeah,
asking.
the Invisalign is invisible braces. That's what I want to get. And, you know, again, it's something that I'd like to get sometime in the near future. But the problem with me has been due to my low status, I don't really make that much money. So, and these things are extremely expensive. I mean, Invisalign alone, we're talking thousands of dollars here, anywhere from
It's
4 to 5 thousand.
actually more expensive than traditional braces, dental
Are
braces.
they? Oh, wow.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, because the fact that they're invisible and, you know, there's not a, they're not as, you know, obvious when you have them on. They're
You
clear
guys know
braces, so.
Dr. Mike Mew? You guys Mew? You know what that is?
Not sure.
No, I'm not
Dr.
familiar with
Michael?
that guy.
Oh, yeah. I just became familiar with it. It's he just in the last couple of years has become popular kind of in the incel community a little bit. He did some Q&A off incel forums. He's a third generation dentist, and I don't know if he's an orthodontist or not, but basically he's been raising awareness about proper oral posture and how at rest, oral posture is supposed to have your tongue at the roof of your mouth, and apparently that influences the development and the position of your mandible, your maxilla, and your zygomatic bones, as well as your teeth as well. So he was saying that in previous generations, it was rare for someone to have crooked teeth, and
Yeah.
it was because of their diet and then
Yeah.
also their oral posture. Their diet consisting of using their muscles of mastication or chewing about 20 times as much as we use them today because of our soft diets, soft, hyper-palatable, delicious diets.
Right,
But
so Andy,
anyway,
for people who
using mewing might help a little bit, not really clearly when you're an adult, but it's a good thing to do is to just keep that oral
Yo, what up,
posture in mind.
Olin?
And
What
go
up?
look up Dr. Mike Mew. What's
So,
up?
Andy, for anybody who
Not that
isn't
that's gonna
familiar
replace
with you,
braces, but
please
oh hey,
introduce
what's up?
yourself, and give yourself an introduction. So, for anybody
Oh,
who's
okay.
not familiar with you.
Got it. Well, I guess you would classify me as a red pill. Some people might argue that I'm a purple pill, but I really don't think so. I think you just have to listen to the nuance of what I'm saying, and then I'm a red pill fella. But I am 26 years old. I wouldn't consider myself particularly high on the money max scale. So pretty low there right now. But yeah, status, medium, nothing super spectacular there. And looks probably like a, I don't know, depends who you ask. 6.5, 7 out of 10 in the face, maybe. About 6'1". Been into lifting weights and stuff. Was a personal trainer for like 6 years, so I come from that perspective. And I'm just into, I'm not an incel, but I'm interested in, how can we change the mindset of maybe some of the people in this community so that we can enhance lives. And that would be through actual like looks max, money max, status maxing, but also through changes in how we're looking at things,
So
and maybe not
basically,
being quite so black pilled. Because I don't like the black pill as far as if the thesis is this is the way it is, you got to just accept it, stop doing this and that, stop coping, stop being a cuck, whatever the case may be, like suicide fuel. I don't like that kind of stuff. I think that's very, very toxic. So I really would like to see more of a not a ridiculously positive attitude to the point where it's just unrealistic and naive, but I want to see a more just a more positive outlook and a more solutions-based mindset in the incel community.
All right. Thank you for the introduction. That's Andy. And so, yeah, it's ultimately what we want. You know, we want to basically find an answer to this problem, you know. And in doing so, I came up with a list because I had a conversation with Andy. And we came up with a list of things that, you know, if you educate yourself on as a man, it should be beneficial in the long run, you know, and help you. If you find yourself, you know, it's a lot of lonely cold nights, it's a lot of darkness, it should put you in a position to where you can ultimately get out of that. And the first one is, I have a list of topics right here. The first one is male dominance hierarchy. So what would you like to speak on the male dominance hierarchy in human beings, Andy, and how it affects a man's SMV, sexual marketplace value?
Sure. So
if you disagree with anything Andy's about you can just jump in.
For sure.
I don't know if Albert's still on the line. Yo, Albert, are you still on the
line? Albert,
are
you there? Oh, no.
Okay, he's here. He just joined again. Albert.
Okay.
Yeah, disconnected for a sec, guys. I don't know why.
Okay, so he just asked me about
Albert, the social dominance hierarchy. You can interject at any time if there's something that Andy says that you don't agree with.
Yeah, that's why you're here, for sure, because we want different perspectives. We don't just want me just talking the whole time and he'd just nodding on or whatever.
So
the social dominance hierarchy, this is a concept. I have a very layman understanding of this. I'm no expert in it, but I read Jordan Peterson's book, 12 Rules for Life, and he speaks about the social dominance hierarchy. Hopefully some of you out there are Jordan Peterson fans. Great guy. But the social dominance hierarchy, just to kind of iterate on what it is, if you think back to when humans were undergoing a trans species evolution phase, back when we were basically designed to live in tribes of 50 to 100 people, and there's going to be in every community a hierarchical structure where some people, and it's different for men and women, but within the males, some men are going to be higher on that hierarchy than others, and there's different roles and different experiences with the different levels that you're at, basically. So if you're at a very high level, you're at a position of authority with abundant access to resources, food, women, and I guess miscellaneous resources too. So you're going to have an abundance mindset, and you're going to have a very low level of anxiety, generally speaking, and you're going to come at things from a position of strength, a mindset of strength, a paradigm of strength. Whereas if you're very low on the social dominance hierarchy, and your brain can actually sense this, the reptile part of the brain, the amygdala can sense if you've had success, continuous successes, or continual failures, that will program your brain as to where you are in the social dominance hierarchy. Or at least where it thinks you are in the social dominance hierarchy. This is observed in fish as well. I mean, there's certain species of fish that will change different colors and experience different gene expression based on where they are on the social dominance hierarchy. So we express this in one of the ways by the amount of serotonin we secrete, as well as other chemicals, I believe, like catecholamines, which are for adrenaline and cortisol and stuff like that. So we're going to secrete a lot more serotonin if our brain perceives us to be high up on the social dominance hierarchy. And so if you're low down there and you're lacking serotonin, your brain has this empty feeling and you crave it, and you'll do anything to get it back. And that's why for people who are kind of in that dire situation where they feel hopeless and defeated, everything that would normally be painful is more painful because they don't have serotonin and opioids in their brain. And they're going to be more anxious about things. They're going to be more irritable. Things are going to bother them more. And if they're more likely to succumb to cravings like food, drugs, alcohol, because all those things, masturbating, all those things are going to feel better because they're lacking that serotonin that they should be getting. And that affects your sexual marketplace value. Women are programmed to be attracted to men that are high on the social dominance hierarchy, because it to an extent, it doesn't matter how many, women a man can impregnate at one time. A man can impregnate as many women at one time as, I mean, there's no limit. But a woman only has one uterus, so she has to be really picky about who she allows to fill that uterus with their DNA. So she wants to be coupled with the highest status male around, ideally speaking.
If you get that, and women do have options.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, and they want to be with, they're programmed at least, maybe not intellectually,
right,
100%, but on a very primal level, there's an urge to be with the highest male on this scale, because he's the most powerful, he can provide those resources, the most protection.
So, let's talk about, the characteristics. Can you please talk about the characteristics of a man who is high on that social dominance hierarchy, and what can a man who's assuming he's very low, what could he ultimately do to, or what, how does that manifest itself? Can you just give examples of how a guy who's low on that totem pole, what characteristics does he try to display?
What characteristics might he display if he's low on the social dominance
and
hierarchy?
He's trying to ultimately, improve himself.
Easily threatened by annoyances, may they be inanimate or from another man. I mean, he's just going to be easily threatened. His frame of mind is going to be easily threatened. If, I just don't know another way to put disturbed.
What I was asking is, okay, coming from the mindset and the mentality of a man who has low SMV, so he has low sexual marketplace value. Let's say he says to himself, "All right, I'm at the bottom of the list, man. I'm at the bottom of the totem pole. What characteristics can I, what can I do? What can I display in order to?"
What can you display to come out of it?
What can I display that when perceived by women, they'll perceive me as having,
a high social dominance hierarchy status. Okay. Yeah. It's hard to kind of pinpoint it on the head, but one example would be, standing tall with your shoulders back and your chin tucked is good posture. If you've ever noticed when you maybe feel embarrassed about something, it takes a lot of effort to not lean forward. If you're actually feeling truly, truly embarrassed or humiliated, you want to lean forward and kind of hunch over. It's hard not to do that just because it's hardwired pattern in our brain. So stand tall, shoulders back. When you speak from your abdomen rather than your chest. If you're taking like singing lessons, you kind of know what that is a little bit. And I guess it depends. I mean, Heed, you've been bringing it to my attention that, it depends where you live as far as what type of people you're around, but assuming whatever situation you're in is not a legitimately dangerous situation, just be confident and friendly to people. Look them in the eye, say, "Hey, how's it going?" And that's a very simple way to do it. That's what I...
So, Albert, what is
if your day's going well.
Albert, what is your take on that? Do you agree that as a man who has low SMV in life, your life has been nothing but hell when it comes to women. You're taking a lot of losses, basically. So it's a lot of L's in the, L column. Do you think you could ultimately, what Andy said right now, do you think you can, basically put those tools in your tool belt and use that and display those, what he basically said, like stand tall and everything.
And it could be that he already does, but
could that actually improve your situation, you think, if you were to do those things and adopt those things?
Okay. So here's what I think. I think that If you do those things, you may be able to kind of fool yourself into believing that you have a higher SMB, but there's no replacement for the real deal, man. You either have a good bone structure or you don't. Period. I believe that if you have a recessed jawline, asymmetrical features, even if you do stand tall with a good posture and you talk from the abdomen and you carry yourself in a manner that is, like you're not ashamed of who you are, that isn't gonna necessarily bring success with, the opposite sex. So
So you're saying that looks ultimately
I
trumps
agree with you.
everything.
I do believe, yes. I believe that looks are everything, yes. I believe that even if you are a hunchback and this and that, so long as you've got a good bone structure, you're good. It's like having a cheat code for life. It's like you've hacked the game and you've put in the cheat code to life, and you have access instantly to all the girls you want, or whichever ones you want. So while I do think it is admirable, working on yourself in those ways, making sure you have a good posture, that sort of thing, it ultimately, I believe, it is in vain. It's really all of it's just making up for the fact that you don't have a good bone structure, in my opinion, and that
Yeah, and it
includes.
wouldn't replace having a good bone structure. It
That
wouldn't
includes.
replace that.
Yeah, no, there's nothing can replace it. I mean, that includes if you're money maxing, you're trying to climb up the corporate ladder or something like that. Really, that may help if you're going after certain types of people, like, for example, gold diggers. But if you're just going for the average person out there, it really may not get you that much success as you would have hoped by, being a successful businessman and such. It's sad, really, but I feel that's the reality of the situation that's going on in today's world.
My point wasn't necessarily that it's going to replace having a good bone structure or magically fix your bone structure or anything like that. But whatever bone structure you have, you're going to live it to the better potential if you do carry yourself with good posture and with, as cliche as it sounds, with confidence or just being friendly and approachable and high energy. And by high energy, don't take it to the extreme. I don't mean having a ridiculous amount of energy, but just being in a good mood. It's gonna maximize your potential for whatever bone structure that you do have.
So that's another thing. So you believe that in addition to the first behavioral trait that we were discussing, now you just introduced Andy another behavioral trait. You said have upward emotions, or no, when you communicate, you ultimately want to, when the way that's received to people, men and women, you want it to have upward emotions, correct?
Right, definitely, definitely. Yeah, let's come back to that one second. So, one thing that I did want to say that the reason I'm not like super black pilled and the reason that I am red pilled is I just know so many people. And I said in the last video that there is a point at which you probably are fucked. Like, if you reach a certain level of being short and like a certain, like, small size of penis and like a certain amount of facial deformity, there's a point at which you're just fucked, probably. But I mean, we've all seen people who they're with girls that are out of their league. I mean, can we all admit that?
Albert, what do you want to say about that, Albert?
I think that there's always something behind that situation that I feel like we're not getting the full picture whenever something like that, because all we're seeing is a guy with a girl. Like, we don't know what's going on behind the scenes. Maybe there's a specific set of circumstances that has been, facilitates that relationship. For example, gold diggers, et
Yeah,
cetera, et
that's what I was thinking.
cetera.
That's the only thing that came to my mind. So you think that the only explanation of that, I mean, can you think of any other examples besides money?
Well, if he has high status, for example, celebrity status, what comes to mind is the Dan Bilzerians of the world, the Hugh Hefners,
He's got all
etc.
three. He's got looks when he says.
That's what comes to my mind. Because the bottom line is, the female, I believe, is ultimately trying to find the highest possible mate in order for her to create the best offsprings. And, all it takes is a few seconds to analyze your face and for them to determine that, nah, this guy isn't what I'm looking for, or yes, this guy is what I want. So, if you don't have it, you're screwed, in my opinion. I mean, you can try to, like I said before, I believe in looks maxing. I believe that's the only answer. Like, if you got big ears, go to a surgeon and tell him, hey, how can I fix this? If you got a big nose, do something about it. Rhinoplasty, whatever it takes. Whatever it takes to improve your overall looks. If you want to change it, these days, you could do a lot of things these days. You could even permanently change your eye color. You can, of course, there's plastic surgery,
I saw a
things like
plastic
that.
surgery. I saw an episode of The Doctor, so the guy changed his eye color and he like went blind in an eye.
Yeah, I mean, of
Anyway.
course, there are risks to these things, but if you're willing to take on those risks, they may be worth it if you find success at the end of the road. The problem is, though, it's an expensive endeavor, and of course, the results are not anywhere near guaranteed. So it's just really, you're just hoping for the best, you know?
Right. I mean, I just you and I just differ in how black and white we really think it is. So I mean, you're thinking every single time you see a guy. I mean, my point is that I think that with superior social skill or other quality traits of your personality, it is possible to at least to some extent overcome looks, money, status, to some extent, not to ridiculous extents necessarily, but I think it's definitely worth looking at. Yeah.
Hey, yeah, I just want to let Andy know if you knew your camera was on.
Oh, is it? Oh, shoot.
Yeah. I mean, if
Okay.
I don't care, I don't know if you
Oh yeah, we can
wanted
see
it on or
like
not.
the your ceiling
Yeah,
fan.
because it looks like you're just talking to your phone like a phone, but I don't know if you knew it was on. I just want to let you know. So
Oh God. Okay.
that you believe, so Albert, do you agree that those are two characteristics that you can adopt in order to improve your situation, and whether or not it'll be impactful?
Was that he?
The two characteristics that a man can adopt, do you believe that if he adopts those two characteristics that we just discussed, basically, carrying yourself as a man, as far as like walking tall or whatever, and then also
Yeah.
speaking to
I
people?
mean, look, man, if you're this dude, like, let's say if you're like a curry cell, which is like an Indian guy, and you're like got your chest out and shit, you're trying to act all barrel chested, people are gonna see through that shit, man. I mean, you could act like a Casanova, but that doesn't make you a Casanova. You're just role playing at that point,
So this brings another great topic, the fact that you say that. This brings the topic of, do you care what people think about in regards to you? So the way you, do you worry or are you concerned about people's perceptions of you?
Right. So sorry, we were going to come back to that other topic of the emotion spiking or conveying emotions when you talk to people. I think that this is something that a lot of people that I personally know struggle with, and I have definitely struggled with it in the past. When you're making sure that you're conveying emotions to people, that's how people connect with each other. Is they share the same emotions and they recognize that they're sharing the same emotions. That's fundamentally what you do when you connect with someone, when you like someone. So, when it's important, I think it is very important and very underemphasized that you have to be good at small talk and you have to be able to make conversations. So if you say, let's say that you're talking to someone and they're telling you some small talk story, and they're like, "Oh yeah, my dad drives a Pepsi truck for a living," and you could pick, and then they run out of things to say, you run out of things to say. You could pick any three of those things. You could pick dad, Pepsi, truck, or you could even pick for a living. And that's four branches that you could basically go off of, and you could just pick any one of those things and just start telling a relatable story or anecdote or talking about that topic. And a lot of people just run out of things to say. This is not everybody, but this is kind of the more socially awkward people. You guys know what I mean? Does that make sense?
It does make sense. So you're basically saying to develop conversational skills and become a
Yes.
conversationalist, and that'll help you when it comes to women.
If you're, I mean, yeah, I think there are below average looking men who will date very attractive women, but none of them have bad social skills. They all have good social skills. And one thing, especially, this is all people, but probably a little bit more when it comes to women, you need to make sure that you're conveying the emotion, like I said. So, I mean, for example, if she's saying, like, you're interested in her, you just met her, and she says she's from New York City. So basically the worst thing you could do is say, like, oh, New York, that's cool. I mean, what you want to do is you want to be like, either if you actually like her and you want to be interested in the conversation, you could be like, oh, fuck that place. I hate that place. Or like, oh, I love that place. That's awesome. And say something about why you fucking hate it or why you like it so much. But if you say just like the most boring thing you could possibly say, like, oh, New York, oh, that's cool. That's the most boring thing you could possibly say. They'll respond more and they'll remember it more if there's some emotion behind what you're saying, ups and downs. It doesn't all have to be positive either.
So do you believe that if guys who are in a bad situation ultimately convey that emotion when they're speaking to women, that they'll be better off in the long run because the women will actually see and be attracted to them? Like, because they're like conveying that emotion, like
Yeah.
spiking emotions, like you said.
You will at the very least make some female friends if you're extremely unattractive and you're a good conversationalist at the very least. And if you look smacks just a little bit and you work on kind of familiarizing yourself and overcoming some different obstacles, then yeah, you could definitely become a lot more successful, in my opinion.
So
I know
Albert, I
so many
mean,
guys that
what do
this
you
is the
think, Albert? I know
bottleneck.
Albert wants to is dying to respond.
Yeah, go
Albert, what do
ahead.
you
I
think, man? Do you
mean,
think that?
here's.
Go ahead.
Oh, what was that, he?
No, I was gonna just make sure you like reiterate. So, do you agree that if you, as a man, when you're communicating with women, if you spike emotions, whether you feel strongly either way, positively or negatively, that will make them attracted to you?
Man, I think that whole silver tongue act, I don't know. That I don't really think that'll work because let's say all right, let's say you're the greatest conversationalist ever. All right, yeah, but that doesn't mean you're gonna seal the deal, man. That doesn't mean that you're gonna get a win-in, you know what I mean? Like, yeah, you're gonna have this awesome conversation, but what's gonna happen at the end of it? All right, see ya. Peace out. See you around. See you in the next life. You know, it's
That's
like
if you're
that'll be that.
boring. I mean,
Well, I mean, because here's the thing too, man. Like, only unattractive guys have to try like that. The
I know.
higher level guys, they don't have to develop a personality. They don't have to develop any sense of social skills. All they got to do is show up, and that's it. That's enough.
That's somewhat true,
They
but
don't even have to say a word. So, you know,
that's
I
somewhat true, but
understand guys who don't really want to put forth that kind of effort because in my mind, I rationalize it like this. Man, why the fuck am I gonna put forth all this goddamn effort when Chad just shows up and just swoops her off her feet
and let me ask you
right
something.
from the
What is
get-go?
the extent of the communication that Chad has to put forth? Like, what is the ex
Me
what
or
is the
Albert?
yeah what like either one of you, like what extent of communication does Chad have to put forth to in order to wet a bitch's panties? Because I believe it's as simple as like, hey, baby.
Sometimes nothing. Sometimes what's up, nothing. Girl? Sometimes yeah, nothing.
Or just on the strength of her checking you out, you could already get her excited.
Sometimes nothing, yeah. But I mean, if that kind of attitude is exactly what I'm really hoping decreases in the incel community is like, oh, like we have it worse. Why should we even try?
That's part of the black pill, you know, like we should, because, I mean, dude, I don't know, man. Some of these guys, they're just not willing to put forth the effort. Let's just be honest. And I know. So, you know, what can you do? I mean, we know what the problem is. It's all about looks maxing, and if you ain't got it, you ain't got it. You know, I don't know. It is a depressing notion. I understand that, and that is highly demoralizing to have that mentality. But the only reason we even have this mentality is simply due to the reflection of what we see out in the real world. You know, we see the Chads getting all the wins, and, you know, all the incels, they get nothing but losses. So what the, you know, I don't blame them for being like, you know what, fuck this. I'm just giving up.
It's funny that you say that. So this is a question both of you guys can answer. So let's say we have somebody who's been battered and broken, and it's a man, you know, he's just been striking out, and, you know, he's in a very dark place of depression, anxiety, low self-esteem, you know, loneliness. What is the first thing that he could do in order to get himself out of that situation and improve his situation and actually put an end to the lonely nights and the cold nights?
That's a good question. It probably depends on why he's an incel. Does he have friends? Friends and family?
Let's say maybe he has a few friends. I don't know, man.
Yeah, I mean, hang out with your friends, and I mean, you could, if he has standards that he's trying to meet, he could try lowering his standards for him. And otherwise, if he's a complete trucel and he literally can't get even a super unattractive woman, then I think he's gonna have to rely on just hanging out with his friends. And if his friends aren't cool, then he needs to get new friends.
Dang.
You know, because right. It's not a super fast, like, you know, snap fix with, you can't just like stand up tall and pull your shoulders back and do this and that and then you're good.
Man, for real, huh?
It's a slow process for some guys. It's gonna be a very slow process.
Is that ultimately, when it's all said and done, is that like extremely demoralizing, the fact that a guy is put in a situation where it's like, you know what, I don't have any women checking for me, you know, I'm just, you know, I'm basically, you know, I'm living hell, you know, so, you know, and I see everybody getting what they want, but I don't want to, at the same time, I'm a man, you know, I was raised as a man, so I know that you're not supposed to feel sorry for yourself and you're not supposed to seek help. But what you know, so what am I left to do? I'm basically left to just stay in this pain, you know, and suffer in silence.
Yeah, and it's good that the community exists that we can speak openly about it. And I think we should talk. I think we should talk openly about solutions, and that's what I'm trying to open the gates to more of, is just more talking about our own difficulties and our own solutions, rather than just kind of, I mean, either ignoring things or more just kind of blackpilling it. But yeah, I mean, hopefully you have a friend or two or a family member that you can open up to and talk about your problems. Cause I mean, I think if you are, I mean, I think fathers or father figures have a duty to talk to their sons about this type of thing, because it's such a big part of life, and it takes mentorship to understand these things. But if you don't have a father or father figure that's experienced or willing to do that, then just find a friend to confide in. It has to be a good, trusted friend. But I think it really helps to talk about stuff. I mean, what do you think, Heed?
Yeah, I mean, I know that, you know, most people hearing this conversation, they would think, the first thing they would think is, depending on how they're calibrated, you know, depending on where they are in life. But I truly believe that most people who are have forward momentum, if they hear guys complaining, they're just going to automatically think, what the fuck? Like, what the fuck is that? Like, you guys are, you're crazy. You know, you're crazy for even having that mentality. But like I said, they never walked a day in your shoes. They don't really know. So it's ignorance partly on their end. But I'm just saying, like, going back to being aware, having social awareness and being aware of how people might perceive you, you know, that's not something you necessarily want to put out there as a man, because now it tarnishes your track record. If people find out that, you know, you don't got it all together, man, you can't hold your shit together, you know, it's on your track record that you're just a wreck, you know, you're a big mess. And that's not something you want, you know, to be associated with.
Right. No, it's not. And you don't want to, I mean, you want to be aware of who you're putting it out there to and who you're broadcasting it to, because it comes back to the, I mean, how you're perceived in social dominance hierarchy as well. It's so not ever going
to
be.
You don't want to just, like, let's say go to the, you know, go out somewhere public and be like, hey, man, you know, I ain't got no hoes. You know, you don't want to do that.
It's your choice, but you want to consider the consequences of doing that.
And let me rephrase that. So you don't, like, let's say you're in a social setting, right? And they're like, oh, yeah, you know, it's this girl, it's that girl. What's up, man? You know, you don't want to say, oh, hey, man, what's up? Do you have any kids? Like, somebody asks you that. And you're a grown ass man. What do you say? Do you lie in order to make yourself look good, or you just say, "Oh no, man, I don't have no kids," or they say, "Hey, you know, how's your girl?" You'd be like, "Oh well, shit." Would you be honest in that situation? You know, let's say
you. I mean, you should.
If you are alone as a man, do you be honest? Or should you be honest in that situation, or should you say, "Oh yeah, man, right. I got a 10-year-old daughter," you know, blah blah, you know, baby mom at home, you know, what do you?
Oh my god. Yeah, I mean, I don't know if I want to just explicitly say what to do in that situation, but I want to provide some insight as to the consequences of certain course of action in that situation. But you shouldn't have a problem with, I mean, people asking you stuff. Does that come up a lot? I mean, because you don't have to lie and say you're an incel if someone asks if you have a daughter or if you have a girlfriend. You can just say, no, I don't have one right now. You know what I mean?
Right.
Does that stuff come up a lot? Is that people ask, well, like, probing questions?
A lot of people ask, you know, when someone's trying to get to know you, usually, typically, that's something that they will ask, if you have any kids or stuff like that.
Well, I mean, why would you say you're like, yeah, like, yeah, I'm an incel, I don't have any kids. Like, you probably wouldn't
say that.
You
don't
want to
say that.
Because my point I mean, not even the fact that, I mean, let's put aside the fact that incel, unfortunately, huh? No, let's put the fact that incel has a violent connotation in the last few years, unfortunately. But Albert left.
It's showing that he's gone. Yeah.
Oh.
I don't know, man. He keeps it. Okay, he's back.
There he is.
Yo, I keep disconnecting, man. I think it's because my data, like right now, my high speed data has gone out. And since I don't have a Wi-Fi connection at the moment, I think that's why I keep disconnecting.
Oh.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, I keep reconnecting, so it's all good. I'll just keep reconnecting.
So, all right, man.
Sorry.
All right, man.
Anyway, to the consequences here, you just want to be aware. You want to, like, on one hand, you hear people always saying, like, oh, I don't care what people think, and it's like this admirable thing that you don't care what people think. It's true to an extent. But everyone cares what at least specific people think. It's just that it's associated with the social dominance hierarchy to be on the higher tiers of that. You can't care what everybody thinks, or you will likely not care what everybody thinks, because you have so much abundance. There's enough people who like you. You have enough resources. You have enough sexual partners and stuff that you are not worried about what any one person thinks. But in general, everyone cares what people think. So if no matter where you are in the dominance hierarchy, if you're really low, You should care what people think, but you don't need to broadcast that you're anxious about it, because basically broadcasting that you're depressed, anxious, sad, defeated, unconfident, any of those things, those are all associated with being super, super low on the social dominance hierarchy, and none of those features will ever be attractive, ever. They're never going to be attractive. If someone finds you attractive after you've said those things, it's always despite knowing those things. It's never because they knew those things. No woman ever felt sorry for a man and felt more attracted to him because she felt sorry for him. If a woman feels any kind of like attraction or any kind of iteration of attraction toward a man that she feels sorry for, it is always despite feeling sorry for him. When a woman feels sorry for a man, it's like her nurturing instincts, like, treat him as if he's a child, not as if he's a viable mate. So you just want to be careful who you broadcast, like, oh yeah, I'm an incel, or like, oh yeah, I'm TFL. You just want to be careful who you like broadcast that to. Exactly. Out in real life. You do want to talk about your problems, though. You do want to sort through things with people. Find a therapist or your dad or a father-like figure or a trusted friend.
Yeah,
that's my take on it.
Because, you know, just because you have a bubble where you're able to talk about certain things, society, it's a lot of, you know, there's a lot of things where, okay, you just cross the line. All right, man, you just violated. If you speak on certain things and you make yourself look bad or you show anything that isn't strength, there are certain communities that will say, all right, man, you just, we're not accepting you, man. Like, you're lame, basically. You know?
Right, and it's all, it can be explained through evolution, too. I mean, it's the same psychology with marketing. It's the same psychology with that. A business is never going to say, oh, yeah, we're doing terribly. We're not selling any of our product, because people are going to be like, well, why the fuck is anyone buying this product? And they're just going to, and they're going to, it's going to continue to downward spiral. It's the same with sexual market value. If you say, oh, yeah, my sexual market value is super low, then women are going to be like, they're going to be extra just looking for those reasons why it's low. So they're going to be extra sensitive to those reasons, and they're going to have prejudice against you, and it's only going to work against you. So just be careful.
It ultimately brings you to the point where a man has to look himself in the mirror and ask himself, in order to have success when it comes to women, should I become a clown? Should I become an entertainer to women? Should I, like, have a lot of energy and display a lot of energy and, like, make a lot of movements and make a lot of gestures and make funny faces? Should I do that? And will that attract women to me? Do you think that's a viable strategy? Both of you guys
answer. I mean, the thing about that is, like, I don't, like, you're only making up for the fact that you're subpar. If you were above average, you wouldn't have to do any of that. All you would have to do is show up, and that's it.
You've already said that about things that we've said before, though. I mean, we already established that.
What was that?
That's an already established fact that you already said before, that you're,
yeah,
that's basically what the whole podcast is about. It's how to compensate for being low sexual market
value. I don't think it's that complicated, you know? I mean, because that's what we're talking about right now reminds me of pickup artists and how they prey on the guys who can't get girls by telling them, oh, yeah.
Oh, man.
His connection.
He was saying something juicy.
All right, so
all you got to do is behave in a certain way, and you'll get everything that you ever wanted. All the girls will be swooned by you if you just, you know, pass your shit test, or do this and that, blah, 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 blah. It's all nonsense, man. All that's just, no. All you need is a good bone structure. You're golden. It's the golden ticket. You know,
but
it's like,
we've already established that it's very valuable to have a good bone structure. We've already established that. But
and
that's
so
already,
like, if you don't have that, then I honestly don't think there's any other way you can make up for it. I mean, yeah, there's money maxing, but I mean, let's say you have excellent social skills. All right, I don't think that's going to get you laid in the end, personally. I
So
really don't.
neither of you guys believe that cultivating your social skills as far as being very talkative as a man and being very expressive and making a lot of movements and body language and gestures that with the intent of eliciting positive emotions from a woman, you guys both don't think that's a viable strategy, or do you?
Getting positive emotions. I mean, that'll only get you. You know what that's gonna do, Heat? That's gonna get land you directly into the friend zone, and
And the
you're gonna
reason why
stay
I ask
there.
that is because that's a, okay, so you believe it'll take you to friend zone. The reason why I ask
Absolutely.
that is
That's gonna land you straight smack dab in the middle of the friend zone.
because when I go out, that's what I typically see. I'll see like a group of people, and I'll see that one guy who is basically doing the most. You know, he's being very expressive. He's talking a lot, and I'm thinking, you know,
Yeah.
maybe that actually worked. You know, like maybe he does get female affection on an intimate
And
level.
I think it just, it's, I think you're, at least in my mind, how I'm perceiving it, you're oversimplifying it a little bit. I mean, I think there's situations where it makes a lot of sense to be very expressive and to make a lot of gestures and things like that. I wouldn't say you want to be a clown, because being a clown and just saying clever shit all the time, that's not necessarily going to get you laid or anything like that. But when you think of when you think of who in a group would be like a leader, women are more attracted to leaders, and men are too, actually, as far as not necessarily from a sexual standpoint, but men want to associate with the leader of a group. Men want to be friends with the leader. Women want to be with the leader because it's just an attractive
All
role.
right,
It's
it's
hard
great that
learned.
I'm glad you brought that
So,
up. I'm very
but you're
glad.
not, if you
Go
look
ahead,
at a
go ahead.
leader, is the leader always like, is are they shy and quiet and monotone? Or is a leader enthusiastic and has a lot to say? Generally speaking, it's the latter. Generally, leaders are extroverted. They're confident. It's all those things.
All right, so.
Oh,
Okay, now let's branch off to a similar, this is basically the cousin of that situation. So let's say a man is basically striking out, man. He's
want to
just going
talk
up to
to
bat, and when it comes to women, it's just constant fails, constant losses. He just can't catch a break, right? He feels like life is just effing him over. What I want to
right?
ask you is, let's say he says, you know what? He looks in the mirror, he goes on YouTube, he finds something, and let's say he says, well, maybe I should try something new because obviously what I'm doing ain't working. So let me go back to the drawing board and let me
I'm gonna go
come
play
up with
games.
something. And what he ultimately comes up with is, rather than be
No.
a entertainer to a woman, he says, you know what? I'm just gonna carry myself very serious. I'm gonna take life very serious, and I'm gonna have a very, I'm gonna hold a very masculine frame, and hopefully that'll work. Do you think that's a strategy that will ultimately be effective? If a guy is just, he just can't win for some reason, do you think he could ultimately come to the place where he does have a win and it's as a result of him having a very masculine frame, basically, carrying himself like he's super serious and angry?
Well, I think I know what Albert's gonna say, but I would disagree with that. I think, generally speaking, mostly disagree, because I think you come off as unapproachable at that point, most likely, and you come off as somebody who takes themselves too seriously, and people might just laugh at you behind your back. In my opinion, and that's if you're like walking around with like a stone cold stare all the time. I mean, it only would work if you would combine it with being lighthearted and being friendly, in my opinion. That's the only way it would really work. But there are probably going to be
I don't
those certain
know.
women who are very attracted to a very serious, stern type man, but I think that's the minority of women, because you need to build comfort. And that's not going to be very comfort building if you're taking yourself super seriously and you can't take a joke.
So you believe that in order to, this is a great conversation. This is a great line of that we're on right now. A good tangent. So you believe that instead of doing that, that you should branch off and actually have, play around a little bit with a woman and like entertain her and get her to open up, I guess, or get her to relax around you. So you should play around, say something silly and to make them her laugh.
I think so for the vast majority of women, yeah. I think there are probably a minority of women who would
Sure.
react well to a very serious demeanor, but overall, people need to build comfort with each other. And that's male friends too, but especially when it's male to female, the woman needs to feel somewhat comfortable with you, and she needs to enjoy being around you too. So if you're super serious, I mean, I know people who are like this. They're super serious and they're super monotone. Like the girl texts you and they're like, the girl's like, "Hey, how are you?" And the guy's like, "Well," with a period at the end. "You?" Question mark. It's like, no, don't say that. Like, don't say that. Why don't you just say like, "Hey, what's up?" Like, just be low key about it.
So this is a great
People
question
laugh at
here.
people who take themselves too seriously.
But here's the thing. Let's say you have a lot of things going on, so you're just a man in the world and you see certain things and you realize, I'm basically getting
What?
raped. The life is raping me, so let me just carry myself in this particular demeanor and I feel like people will take me serious finally. And because I, women just look at me like a jackass. Men don't respect me, so let me just, let me elevate so I can, improve my situation. Do you think, because I feel like that's the mindset of a lot of guys who do end up doing that, because they want to be taken serious finally, once and for all. They're tired of people not taking them serious.
You asking me that? I mean, we kind of went over that, didn't we? I kind of just ranted about that. What's the difference?
No, because that's we're talking about strategies for guys who are unsuccessful, and that's, I believe, a strategy that some guys actually implement is they'll
Oh,
carry a master key
yeah.
frame.
I've seen that. I think I've seen that before. I mean, where you can tell it's kind of fake looking, but they take themselves too seriously. I think you need to just do a good job of finding the balance of just not taking a shit from people and being assertive and being confident.
Here's the thing,
And
you're not, here's the thing, man. It's all
what's
all about
up?
the halo effect. You're not being assertive and confident when you're below average. When you're below average, you're being an asshole and a douchebag. Yeah, so being confident turns into being an asshole and being what was the other one you mentioned?
Assertive,
Assertive.
confident.
Assertive, people will just think, "Oh, what a jerk." And why is that? Because of the negative halo effect. Below average people get the negative halo effect. Above average people get the positive halo.
You there?
So it's not going to ultimately work for them. You're saying, Albert, that that's just false hope.
Yeah, he left, but he did say that. He got disconnected. That sucks. He keeps getting disconnected.
Yeah, I'm
Yeah,
back, guys.
Albert. So you're basically saying that won't work for below average looking guys.
Yeah, basically, unfortunately, due to the halo effect, like I mentioned, that is the biggest flaw. Like it'll screw you over basically because, it's just how it just goes to show the primitive nature of human beings, and I do believe human beings to be primitive animals in general. Animalistic in nature and, pretty much monkeys with a wrench.
Yeah, I do agree that the halo effect exists. It definitely exists.
Yeah, the halo effect definitely exists, and it's real. Absolutely.
Right,
You
so
know,
what
there's.
I do, I mean, let me put it to you this way though. Do you think that there are, even though the halo effect exists, and even if you are unattractive, do you think there are better and worse ways to conduct yourself, or do you think that every possible way in which you conduct yourself is equally bad?
I think most of the ways are bad because people are just going to perceive it as bad, especially if you're below average. I mean, and that's just due to the I don't know what it is. It's something to do with this is going back to evolutionary and the whole evolution of man and that sort of thing. if you want to get scientific about it. But yeah, it's just how it is. I mean, so instead, like you mentioned, like I mentioned before, instead of being confident, you're really just being a jerk. And instead of being assertive, you're just being a loudmouth asshole because of the negative halo effect.
So you believe that the way that you're perceived by human beings and the feedback that you ultimately receive, that ultimately shapes your perception of yourself and your self-esteem? Plays a huge factor?
And how you perceive yourself? Yeah, I mean, I think so. Yeah, it does. Because
everybody starts off expressing themselves one way or the other. And let's say it's received positively.
Yeah, I'm sorry, guys. I keep disconnecting.
Let's say it's received positively, the way you express yourself, you know, the way you're perceived, then you're going to be a very outgoing, confident person. And, you know,
yeah, those people are. Have you ever noticed how these Chads and Changs, have you ever noticed how they always seem high on life? There's a reason for that. It's because they get nothing but the positive halo effect. And why is an incel always miserable? Because he gets nothing but the negative halo effect. And it feeds off of each other. So there you have it. It's not a coincidence. This is by design. This is how things, like, I believe that there's nothing you can really do to fight that except, once again, looks, Max. That's about it.
So if somebody puts themselves out there, right, in life, and they're met with, you know, just negative feedback, and, you know, despite trying to stand tall, put, you know, have pride in themselves as a man, you know, and let's say it's met negatively, how does that person not end up, you know, being low? How does that person just, you know, have a spirit inside and a mentality where it's like, you know, no, you know, I'm, you know, you're all wrong, I'm right. You know what I mean?
The only way I see that,
I'm the motherfucker that's right, and you continue.
There is a way that can happen, and the only way that can happen is if the individual that's being inflicted is completely and utterly a narcissistic egomaniac. So really, you know, he's an extreme narcissist. Extreme narcissist. You know, only it's all about me, me, me. And I'm actually kind of like that, to be honest. And I believe it's been a coping mechanism of TFL to be a, you know, self-centered and that sort of thing. Yeah, narcissistic in nature.
Sure. Okay, well, I mean, the reason I asked you the question, do you believe that every method of conducting oneself, if one is ugly, is equally bad, or are some better than others? I mean, yes or no question. Are some better than others or no?
Some ways of conducting yourself? Give me a few examples of that. Conducting yourself how? This way?
Just the way you carry yourself.
What we've been talking about, how you carry yourself, how assertive you are, how serious your demeanor is.
Well,
I mean, are there some methods that are worse than the others, or are they all equally bad if you're ugly? It sounds like a stupid question, but he disconnected. He'll be back.
Well, the reason why I bring this up ultimately is because there's a large segment of people who give advice on this situation, such as Alpha Male Strategies. He said that he really stresses the importance of, you know, having a masculine frame when you're dealing with women. He says that.
Yeah. So, man, I hate this connection right now. But anyway, go ahead, Albert. Yeah, I think that, you know, there are some, I think there's, you know, there's some things you can do that are worse than others. I mean, but in general, it's all looked at as bad or as unpleasant by other people or unwanted in nature. You know, it's almost like you got leprosy or something. Like, you're tainted. You're not one of us. You're excluded. We're excluding you. You're not part of the pack, you know? That sort of thing. So, I mean, it sucks. And it's a hard pill to swallow.
Right. So what if you're a man who's never been intimate with a woman and you never had a woman say, you know what, you know, you are very handsome.
What do you do in that situation? How do you ultimately have that confidence to
honestly
get what you want
I'm,
out of life?
I wouldn't believe it. I wouldn't believe it because I can see with my own eyes that it's false. I mean, I have identified my personal issues. I know exactly what I need to do to get, increase my LMS. But, you know, if someone told me that, I would just think that they're trying to be nice.
Basically. Well, he's asking, how do you get the confidence to, what was the question?
The question was this. Let's say you find yourself as a man in a position where there's a lot of lonely, cold nights, and you don't really have that intimacy with the woman when you're, you know, when you're just being close to a woman, and she's letting you know, she's telling you, like, look, you know, you are very handsome. That's the truth. What do you do as a man if women aren't really feeling you like that, to the point where they actually want to be close to you, intimate with you, and straddle you, and things like that? You know, how do you ultimately have that confidence as a man if you don't have women who just want to, you know, do things to you, if you don't give them that tingle?
So, yeah, you're just basically saying you don't believe them. But you're saying you've never, if the person has never been intimate with the woman, but the woman is basically giving you a compliment.
No, what I was asking is, how does that man have confidence at the end of the day? When it's all said and done, when the dust settles, the smoke clears, and when you boil everything down, how does that man, to his core, ultimately have that confidence? You know what I'm saying?
His confidence will have to be, I mean, it'll have to be somewhat fake. And because the only way that you can gain legitimate, thorough competence is through experience and through successes, through continual successes. That's the only way that you can gain, in my opinion, genuine and thorough confidence. But what the confidence can be based off of is an expectation of success. That's the best that you can have.
Yeah, the whole fake it till you make it thing. Yeah, you know, I've tried that before, but here's what's gonna happen to anyone who tries that. They're gonna, all right, so here you are, you're confident, or at least pretending to be. Well, you're gonna run into brick wall after brick wall, and eventually that's gonna deteriorate whatever armor. Well, you're gonna fail. You're not gonna, I mean, I'm sure you've heard of these guys, you know, I've heard of guys like, well, not personally in real life, but of guys who have approached hundreds. I think I even heard one time some dude approached 1,000. 1,000. And not a single one. Not one. So what is that going to do to your fake it till you make it? That's going to completely eradicate it.
Was that guy in that documentary, that Virgin documentary?
I'm not sure exactly who it was. I can't remember, but I just know that someone actually did a 1,000 approaches and not even, you know.
Well, because I saw that too. I saw that guy too. And I mean, my exact thoughts was like, okay, so he's not like, he wasn't like a super good looking guy. He basically had like no masculine features to his face at all. But then again, he wasn't ugly either. He wasn't like actively repulsive. So, I mean, if he would have, I guarantee you that same guy, at least the one that I'm thinking of, in that, like, if you YouTube Virgin Cringe, it's the first video that pops up. And if he would just, I guarantee you, if he'd stop talking so fucking weird and so monotone, and if he'd start wearing better clothes and get a better haircut, he would have had at least a few of those women say yes. And I guarantee you those conversations were super awkward with those women just because of how awkward of a person he is.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to pretend to be confident when you don't have any reason to pretend, because, and you know what? Oreo Man is well known on YouTube for saying this sort of thing. He says, like, and I agree 100%, why would someone be confident if he's never had a reason to be? You know, he has zero wins, so how the fuck is he gonna, he can't, confidence, I mean, I guess he could fake it, but it's not gonna be genuine. It's not gonna be genuine, and so it's rough, man. That's why this thing feeds into itself. It's like,
it definitely feeds into itself.
It's like a black hole that just keeps getting bigger and bigger.
I definitely already agreed with that point, as far as you can't have, like, genuine confidence without some experience of success. You can have a some level of determination, and you can kind of fake it till you make it. That's kind of what you have to do, because, or you could just slowly work your way up, I guess, if you want to tell the woman that you're super unconfident. But
anyway. Yeah, I mean, like, it sucks, because here's the thing too. Like, let's say if you do everything right, you know, you're a good conversationalist, you dress nicely, you get your hair, you're looking as fresh as you could possibly be.
Without your looks, Max.
Yeah. But, you know, you could still fail despite all that. So, I just think that, you know, the guys who, like, the Chads out there, they just got it, man. They just know, they just have something, you know. Like, I don't want to say, like, some sort of power or something, but it's all about the looks.
Well, they do have some sort of power. I mean, the looks do give you some sort of power, literally.
Yeah,
but it's not a magical power, but it is a power.
Superpower, yeah. And yes. And that's why these guys, you know, they're super frustrated, and, you know, they end up either, I'm gonna just keep it real here, they end up either, you know, going ER or just straight up, you know, offing themselves, wasted, you know. And it's sad, you know, this lifestyle claims lives. TFL certainly does. And it ain't no joke, man. This is the real deal. Like, this is the true struggle.
I agree with you. But do you agree that ER, he wasn't that ugly, right? I mean, if he would have just been a normal person,
he had a decent, he could have gotten. He was wealthy as well. But I believe from what I could tell from Elliot Roger is that he wasn't that tall. And I think he was somewhat, well, in his videos, he looked kind of short. Like, I'm not sure exactly his height.
Like, how short? Number. Wait. If he's above 5'3", I mean, I know guys who are 5'3" and less attractive than Elliot Roger who get girls. So, I mean, not that it would be as easy. It's not going to be as easy as if you're a 6'3" Chad, but it is possible. The environment
he was in,
I'm just
was
saying really he had a really weird too. Personality. Yeah, but he had a really weird personality, man. He was a weird dude.
Yeah, I mean, he did have a...
It wasn't just his looks. He was weird.
He had a superiority complex, no doubt, but...
That's a very unattractive thing.
Yeah, but, I mean, is a Chad not going to get the girl just because he has a superiority complex? That ain't going to stop
but that's
him.
Not what it's... But, dude, that's what... I mean, I don't want to come off as too abrasive to you, Albert, but... Every single thing you've said tonight, I mean, basically has had something to do with comparing an insult to a Chad. And that's not what this podcast is supposed to be about. It's supposed to be about what can we all each do to get better. It's not about how can we compare ourselves to someone who has it better than us.
Yeah. I mean, the only thing I can say on that is that you have to look at yourself and truly identify your specific flaws. So it's going to be a case by case basis. There is no one size fits all solution. It's going to have to be tailor made for you, and that's it, you know.
Well, I agree, but that's literally what this whole podcast is supposed to be about. So I mean, the whole point, my whole thesis on in my intro,
any insults out there, I just recommend them to, you know, have a good look in the mirror. And if they see that they have a crooked nose, rhinoplasty. If they see they have asymmetrical eyes, talk to your doctor about it. You know, if you got acne scars, go to the dermatologist, whatever the fuck it is.
Right. I'm not saying not to do that stuff. Bless you. Right. I'm not saying at all not to do that stuff.
A few solutions, you know, a few solutions that may apply to some individuals out there. Those are genuine solutions, but, you know, the problem is, like, those are, you know, they're really expensive to do, and chances are, if you're TFL, you haven't really been motivated to achieve things in life, and so you probably have, you know, a low socioeconomic status, so you're probably making, like, around $20,000 a year, and so that ain't really that much, man. And these things that I'm talking about, they're thousands of dollars that you got to spend on.
So let me ask both of you guys this. Now, this is just being real, you know, and you know, so we can't ultimately live in a society where where women say, you know, but let me give this guy a chance, man. Let me look at this guy's personality, you know. Let me see, okay, he has a good heart. You know what I'm saying? Let me just give him a chance. So it's not going to be based on that. It's going to be based on the way you look rather than the person you are.
Yeah, it's sad. It's
Cool.
sad he, but I do wholeheartedly believe that that is the case, and that's just due to the media propaganda. I mean, no matter what kind of media you look at, whether it's literature, video games, music, videos, movies, it doesn't matter. Like, who's always the protagonist? Who's always the hero? And on average, what does the villain usually look like? He usually looks like, you know, he has the flaws, and the hero usually is, you know, Mr. McBuff. Mr. McBuff, you know,
It's
who
a
could be
Giga
walking
Chat,
down
right, Andy?
Baywatch. What's up?
Andy, the superhero is typically a Giga Chad, huh?
Yes.
Yeah, they
What
usually
was the
look like
question? Was
Superman,
that your
dude.
question, Heath?
The question
Yo,
was
who
this,
would
man.
believe? When was the last time you've seen Superman portrayed with a double chin and a beer gut?
Yeah, never.
Never.
Never,
Never
and it's
will.
never going to be perceived
Yeah, I know
either.
you won't. Well,
Yeah.
let Heath ask his question, please.
So, fellas, so ultimately, you don't believe that a woman can say, you know what, this guy, he has some flaws. You know, he's not the best looking guy. You know,
Nah.
I'm gonna take him around my family and friends, and I'm gonna be embarrassed. But you know what? And I'm gonna be embarrassed to post him on Instagram and Snapchat and stuff like that. You know, I'm gonna, you know, so I probably won't put him on my social media or whatever. Or you know, I won't want to be seen around in public with him. But so there's no way when a woman has that mentality, she cannot ultimately say, you know what, man, I can't get this guy a chance. I can't be close to this guy. I can't, you know, lay down beside this guy and you know, be in, you know, and have a relationship with this guy on an intimate level. Because ultimately, you know, when I lay down and when I lay down at night with him and look him in the face, you know, I just can't do it. You know, he's just disgusting.
Yeah, bro. It's sad, man. But I do think, yeah, I agree with you, Heath, but what you just said on that statement. It's a sad thing, but I mean, it's just human nature. I mean, you know, obviously it has to do with the way the genes reproduce, you know, for better genes passed on to the next generation, et cetera, that sort of thing.
So
And so
she's just gonna be like, it's gonna have to be a situation where you deal with like someone who is actually a sex worker in order for you to actually get that what you want from women. So you're not gonna be able to
yeah.
just, you know, have an organically developed relationship where you look at her, she looks at you, and you know, she's feeling you. It's gonna be half the situation where you have to go see, you have to go pay for it, right?
Yeah, I
That could be the
agree.
case
Yes.
for some men.
Yes, I
Although I think there are a lot
certainly.
of men who think that it is the case for them who it is not, because
And
I
even then, like, even when you go out and do that, like, you're always gonna know that it's not the real deal, that it's only a synthetic,
For
it's
sure.
fake, you know, it's not.
So it's a difference between a woman, you know, basically, you know, she's riding your dick. It's different if it's from a prostitute and from a woman who is truly
For sure,
attracted to
definitely.
you.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
First.
It's totally different. Yeah. Because, you know, one is just doing it as a job and the other one is doing it out of her own free will. So, you know, it's like you would be able to tell the difference if you were to experience
Well, even
one
just the
the
fact that you
other.
know, I mean,
Yeah,
just
it's
that even
common
that is
sense
enough
enough.
to kind of ruin
Yeah.
it, but
It's
anyway.
just sad, man. This whole situation, this whole TFL thing, I think it's gotten worse because of social media and the internet and the invention of things like Tinder and such. But
I'd agree with you. I think it's gotten worse because of that stuff. But
yeah.
hey, I gotta kind of wrap it up here. It's getting late for me here in Minnesota.
All right, man.
So, hey,
Hey,
it's been
thank you
good,
for, yeah, go
but
ahead. Go ahead.
I just want to leave you guys with the thought that, hey, Albert, by the way, thanks for being with us tonight.
Oh yeah, sure, no problem. Even though I kept goddamn disconnecting, I need to get a better connection for next time.
We need to get Wi-Fi on you. But
Yeah, I'll be better prepared next time.
okay, yeah, no problem, man. But I mean, definitely it was it's when I hear you say things like when we're talking about, is there any possible way that, given the situation that people are in, could life be made better by making certain lifestyle changes or developing certain skills? And then basically your rebuttal is always like, well, Chad doesn't have to do that stuff. Chad doesn't have to do that stuff. Chad has a cheat code for life. It's easy for Chad. I mean, you're basically just conditioning your brain to always look at the negative and you're ignoring the solutions because of it. That's my opinion on it. And that's exactly what I'm trying to hopefully minimize in the incel slash TFL community is this mindset of like comparing yourself to Chad all the time. Well, instead of looking at the actual one potential valuable piece of information, you're just focusing on, well, Chad doesn't have to do that. Why do I have to do that? Chad doesn't have to do that. You know what I mean? I mean, that's kind of what I'm trying to, that's
Yeah,
exactly
no,
what I
like
said at the beginning. So.
I just find it demoralizing because, in the back of my mind, I always think about it because it's the truth. I mean, I can't deny it. It's like to not acknowledge that reality would be to have your head in the
Well,
sand, in my opinion.
I'm not saying not to acknowledge it. I'm just saying you don't have to constantly dwell on it to the
Yeah,
point where
true.
it's
It's
interfering with your ability to consider other things.
Yeah, true. I agree with that. It's not a positive thing to focus on. In fact, I would say that if to anyone out there, I would say you really shouldn't even focus on that and instead try to improve your own situation in whichever which way you can. Slowly but surely chip away at whatever issues you have going on. And eventually, hopefully, you'll be able to reach a level to where, you're happy with your situation and move on from
Awesome, man.
there.
Awesome, man. I like what you just said there. Cool. Well,
Yeah,
yeah,
I'm gonna
I'm
end it
gonna
on a
head.
positive note, because it ain't all negative. I mean, yes, Chad has it easy and all that, but I do believe that there are solutions. It's not all hope is lost. It's just that it's hard to get the motivation to actually apply those solutions to your life.
I hear you. I understand that.
So.
For sure, man. All right, guys. Have a good night. Thanks.
All right, then. Peace.
All right, bye.
All right, Andy. Goodbye.
Right, man. That was the part two of the this conversation. We made it a three-way this time. Last time it was just me and Andy, but this time we brought Albert along to offer his perspective, and it was more balanced this time around. So that's what it's ultimately all about, trying to, not be biased and really try to get the bottom of it, because this situation, let's be real, man, this situation can really demoralize you and make you go
Oh
crazy.
yeah.
So you do want to ultimately have some type of some type of hope,
Yeah, of course. I mean, because without some sort of coping mechanism, it'll be hard to live on a day-to-day basis. I mean, you'll just feel like, why am I even bothering to, get up in the morning,
Yeah, because as a man, it's a big problem if you're walking along, you're living your life and you don't have no women lusting after you, no woman finds you attractive, no, on the sight of you, no woman gets excited. That's a horrible reality.
Oh
If
yeah, it
by the sight
is.
of
It's
you don't just excite her, you just gotta live your life knowing like, damn, man, this is a bad position, but all I could do is, try to looks max and money max and hopefully I could get in a better position, because, I don't wanna live like this.
Right, exactly. That's completely right. And I just want to say to any of the TFLs out there, just man, just I know it's been rough, man, and we're living in some shit times here in modern society, but it's just how it is. It's like the world that we got born into. So all we can do now is try to make the best of it and, try to find solutions.
on that note, we're gonna close it down, shut it down. Thank you guys for viewing this. You know, I appreciate it. And once again, thank you, Albert, for being a part of this, man. Hopefully,
no problem.
This opened some people's minds and it offered some type of hope, you know.
Yeah, man, I really do hope that, you know, I know I've been, you know, focused on negativity, but also positivity. You know, it's not all hope's lost. I do think that you can eventually turn things around if you really, really get, you know, apply yourself. So, you know, thanks, Heath, for having me on this podcast. It was fun, even though, you know, I kept disconnecting, but... I'll try to have a better connection for next time.
Thank you for coming on, bro. I appreciate it.
Sure thing, Heed. No problem.
All right, then. And with that, I'm out. Peace.